life. Choose business as usual. Choose polluting the sea, the air, the planet. Choose floods, storms and fires. Choose inaction, denial, waste, convenience. Choose overheating, overmeeting, overdepleting. Choose destruction. These are the choices we were making. Then along comes pandemic. Pause. Lockdown. Out of nowhere. The big wake-up call for us all. So how do we recover? How do we progress? New choices. Big, bold, brave, and beautiful choices. Choose greener, cleaner, smarter, sweeter. Choose kindness. Choose goodness. Choose joy. Choose nature. Full moons, lagoons, mountains, valleys, life on Earth. Choose reforestation, clean energy, protecting our oceans. Choose radical policy change, system change. Choose a healthy economy, sustainable business. Choose a new normal, a brighter, safer next normal. Choose science. Choose less than 1.5 degrees temperature change. Choose the Paris Agreement and sticking to it. Zero carbon, zero waste, zero hate. Choose love. Choose massive regeneration in this generation. Choose brighter, better, all together. It's our choice. Choose life.
Okay, thank you. So hopefully that has got us all in the mood and thinking about the kind of thing that we need to think about for this morning. So my name is Helen Jewell. I am a professional facilitator, and together with Megan to my left, I don't know where she is on your screen, we will be facilitating the morning. And for tech queries, I would point you to Megan. Megan is largely going to be doing the tech support for today. So any problems, if you can send her a message in the chat, then that would be great. And it will be mostly my voice hearing, you will hear in between sort of the speakers and everything. So yeah, we're just gonna do a few bits of housekeeping to start with. As I have said, we are recording this. And yes, if you don't want to be in the recording, then I'll invite you to turn your videos off. We have a hashtag that would be really good if you could use if you're on any social media, Twitter. I don't know how well it will work on Instagram, given that we're visual. But if you would like to use the hashtag, I'm going to ask Megan.
Oh yes,
the Cheltenham Zero hashtag in the chat box.
Right,
I've done that now. And I'd encourage you to use the chat box as well. We are a large number of people. There's actually 49 people in the room at the moment. So if there are any questions, queries, comments, or otherwise, if you could pop them in the chat box, and that will enable us to sort of manage the flow of the day better. And I believe Peter Clegg has offered to try and answer any questions that maybe come up. And we will be keeping a close eye on the chat box. So why are we here? That's a good place to start. This event has come about as a result of a partnership between Vision 21, who've been campaigning for over 25 years for a more sustainable future, and Cheltenham Borough Council, who have some pretty ambitious targets to meet. Today is really the very first step towards the formation of Cheltenham Zero, a cross-sector collaborative partnership between local government, business, education, and community organisations from across the borough, all working to achieve a net zero carbon Cheltenham by 2030. This morning's workshop has members of the business community, and we have another workshop this afternoon, which is open to the wider community. There may be a few terms like net zero that you would like to explore further. We'll have a chance to do this in your breakout rooms this afternoon. We have 2.25 hours this morning, and I'm just gonna share with you the aims of the day. Oops, here we go. So hopefully you can see that. We are working 9:30 till 11:45. The aims of the day are to discuss and decide what actions you can take and what support you could give to enable Cheltenham to reach net zero. to create a coalition of the willing to take this forward. So that's really about creating a collaborative community and to make a public commitment in principle to the agreement. So that's not about sort of signing your life away, signing anything in blood. It's about pledging your support, really. So that's what we're hoping to achieve today. By way of an agenda, we will start properly, officially in a minute when we invite Councillor Max Wilkinson to welcome us. We then have Rachel Kelly, who's going to share some survey results. We have a keynote speech. It's actually a recorded video from Rebecca Willis. We've then got a poll for you to answer a question. We will then go into break. We won't start the breakout rooms, but we're going to give you an overview of how the breakout rooms work. And this is a kind of key part of today. We will have short presentations from each of the breakout room leaders. Then we'll go into a break. And then when we come back from the break, we will go into those breakout rooms. You'll be having an opportunity to discuss a key question that we'll give you. And then we'll have a chance for each group to feedback. We've then got Darren Knight from Cheltenham Borough Council, who's going to talk about the agreement. We've got
Hello, another... and it's actually going to be Mike Redman doing that bit.
Okay, thank you, Mike. We have Mike Redman from Cheltenham Borough Council. Then we have a short video from some youth ambassadors, a really lovely video, another poll, and then we're going to close. So that's the order of today. Now, before further ado, I think the best thing to do would be for me to hand over to Max. I'm just going to stop sharing my screen. So Max, I don't know where you are on my screen, but I would like to welcome Councillor Max Wilkinson.
Sorry I'm late.
That's fine.
I'm in Cheltenham.
Where are we?
That wasn't me speaking there. No, I was on time, everyone.
Okay, whoever that is that's just entered, welcome. If you could pop yourself on mute, we're just waiting to hear from Councillor Max Wilkinson. I can see you now, I've found you on my screen. So if you would like to, if you're able to, swap your view, top right-hand corner, to speaker view, now would be a good chance, and then you can listen to Max only, and I will be quiet. Over to you, Max.
Well, thank you to everyone for coming, and thank you, Helen, for the introduction, and to Megan too for facilitating. And obviously a huge thank you to our friends at Vision 21 for working with us at the council to put this event together. I know a huge amount of administration and work has gone in to get us this far. And that's hugely important. And we know that Vision 21 has been working so hard for such a long time on environmental campaigns in our county. We really value the work that they've been doing. To give you a quick introduction to me, I'm the Cabinet Member for Climate and Communities for Cheltenham Borough Council. I'm also the person who took the motion for carbon neutrality to Cheltenham Borough Council back in early 2019. Back in the autumn last year, I was elected to Cheltenham Borough Council's Cabinet, and my political bosses put me in charge of the sort of the political debate around carbon neutrality and our response to the climate emergency. I suspect because they wanted me to own the thing that I had started and sort of put it in my hands and say, well, you believe in this, so crack on with it then, which may be a double-edged sword, really. The motion that I took to council back at the start of 2019 has two key elements. It's all around a target for carbon neutrality by 2030. And that's not just for Cheltenham Borough Council, that's for the wider Cheltenham Borough too. Now, the council itself obviously ought to be able to become carbon neutral by 2030 because we're in charge of the things that we do, like our buildings and the fleet of vehicles that we operate. But trying to achieve this at a town-wide and a borough-wide level is going to be much more difficult. You'll note that the target that we've set is much more ambitious than national and international targets, and that's because locally we believe that it is really important that we need to go further and faster, because we think that the targets that have been set nationally are not quite ambitious enough. And also we think that Cheltenham is a place where we have a huge amount of expertise and we can make a huge contribution. And also we think we see that there needs to be a form of leadership here that we're taking as a town. And one of the reasons that we were really keen to form a partnership and collaborate with community groups and business groups across the town is because the council knows that it can't do this alone. We simply don't have the resources, we don't have the powers, and we don't have the money to hit the targets for the wider town that we would like to. And indeed, we would like assistance and feedback on our own internal stuff as well, because we know that so many people across our community groups and businesses have the expertise that the council perhaps doesn't have. But also there's a really important point here for me politically. I think that the era of men and women in council offices, and let's be honest, it has usually been men, and there is an issue around equality and climate change here as well, but men in council offices wagging fingers and telling people what they have to do is not the way that things are done in 2020 and 2021. And what we really need to do is have a collaborative approach where we're appreciating that there's a huge amount of expertise and enthusiasm out there in our communities and businesses, and that if we all work together, we will certainly achieve a lot more. So I think from a business perspective, it's really interesting to note that since I've been involved in politics and political campaigning and for my adult life, there's been a huge change in the atmosphere and the debate around business. We've gone from a position where much of the business world viewed environmental policy as something that was hostile to business and a threat to the everyday activities. And now it is something that is proactively embraced by so many larger organisations. I'm thinking about the likes of IKEA, which has set a carbon positive target for 2030, even in excess of what we're aiming for in Cheltenham. And obviously we know that's a huge multinational that is transporting all kinds of things all across the globe. Siemens as well has a carbon neutral target for 2030. And that will automate us think in Cheltenham, because we are a smaller organisation than Siemens and IKEA as a council, but also across the town there are businesses who might like to take a lead from the likes of IKEA and Siemens. And there are countless other examples of businesses that have set similar ambitious goals. And I think this is about the alignment of corporate priorities with environmental goals too. And that isn't just driven by businesses sort of right thing to do, although that is really positive. It's actually being driven by consumers and investors too. And that's an important point that we might want to reflect on today. And the last decade or so of change that we've seen in the debate around environment has clearly sped up in the last year as a result of the pandemic. And people are now much more tuned in to the impact that they're having on the world around them and their communities. So we're all very keen to hear what each other has been doing in Cheltenham, what actions we're already taking. And I'm keen to hear how we can all work together to achieve the target for a carbon neutral Cheltenham by 2030. And hopefully by the end of today, we can set up a formal commitment to a formal Cheltenham Zero partnership and all work together to make our town a cleaner and greener and more environmentally friendly place generally, contributing to the things that we need to do to make sure that our planet survives and our children inherit a world and town that is something that they want to live in. So thank you very much again for everyone for coming, and I look forward to hearing more. I won't contribute very much during the debates, because I think politicians ought to shut up every now and again and listen to everyone else. So I'll be watching the breakout rooms and taking away the feedback. Thank you.
Thank you, Max. If you feel so inclined, there's a reactions button that somebody I can see has spotted on the bottom right of your toolbar. You can give Max a little clap, because it's quite hard to do a clap, an actual clap in Zoom. Thank you. So one of the key things that I heard from that was we can't do this alone, and the need for a collaborative approach, which is really why we're here today. So our next speaker, thank you, is Rachel Kelly, who is going to be sharing. So Rachel Kelly from the Liminality is going to be sharing some survey results. So over to you, Rachel.
Hi, can everyone hear me okay?
Yep.
Great. I'm Rachel Kelly. I'm a freelance sustainability consultant. I'm currently working with Vision 21, the sustainability charity in Gloucestershire. I just wanted to reiterate Max and Helen's welcome and say thank you to everybody for attending today. I know there's lots of other stuff going on for everybody at the moment in the midst of the global pandemic and everything else that's going on, homeschooling and whatever might be happening at home. We actually polled all the attendees in advance of today's events, just to take the temperature on climate issues and to dive a bit deeper into the barriers and motivations for climate action. Rather than death by pie chart PowerPoint this early in the morning, I thought instead we could all kind of do a bit of a thought exercise in pre-COVID times, or even better, actually imagine ourselves in post-COVID times. And imagine that there's 100 of us in a room together. You've maybe shaken hands with people, shock horror. You're maybe sitting right next to other people. Maybe even that most magical circumstances has occurred where you've actually got a nice hot cup of coffee at a conference before you've kind of sat down. So to set the scene with some stats, my green, I believe. So hopefully you can all see that. Do you shout? If not. So yeah, there's 100 of us in the room together. Um, 60% of you are somewhat confident on climate issues and solutions. I should say that 6% of you are not confident on climate issues and solutions. So you are not alone if you are amongst the people who responded saying that you're not yet confident on these issues. We're hoping to plug those gaps in knowledge today. 3% of you are extremely confident. So we're also really lucky to have people in the room who know lots about the issues and the solutions. 77% of you are already aware of CBC's Climate Emergency Declaration and plans. For net zero by 2030. So that's really great to see that awareness already. 91% of you view climate change as a priority within your organisation, which is absolutely fantastic that that's already a really high priority for lots of businesses within Cheltenham. However, only 48% have targets or policies in place to lower emissions. So we really need to start matching the level of priority with the level of action. And you're not alone either in terms of what the barriers to action are. So almost everybody responded saying that costs and finance and funding and expense was the main barrier to tackling this issue, and that time and resources closely followed that. And there's also a huge amount of crossover between what you all thought that the solution areas that you wanted to focus on were. So energy efficiency came out top. And also communications and behaviour change, resource use and renewable energy were also towards the top of the list. And you can see there that 98% of respondents felt that they would benefit from a Cheltenham-based collaborative group of organisations to tackle climate change together. We know that no single organisation or sector can tackle this challenge alone. It's only through innovative and radical cooperation and joined up systems thinking that we can begin to implement the scale of the solutions needed and build back better post COVID. So yeah, there'll be a post event survey going around as well, which will hopefully everyone will respond to who responded to the pre-event survey. So keep an eye out for that. And yeah, there's much more to come this year from Vision 21, including the youth ambassadors who you'll be hearing from later on, and an exciting project called Planet Cheltenham. So keep your ears and eyes open for more from Vision 21 on the Cheltenham Zero project and these other projects throughout 2021.
Thank you, Rachel. Some really interesting statistics there. And I really love the idea of pretending I'm in a virgin and a real space with my cup of coffee. So holding on to that image. Thank you. Where's my clap button? There we go. Right. So next up, we've got a lot that's packed into this these couple of hours. So I'm moving fairly swiftly. I'm going to introduce Rebecca Willis, who's not actually here. We have a video. But Rebecca Willis is a professor in practice at Lancaster Environment Centre, where she holds a fellowship in energy and climate governance. She is an expert lead for Climate Assembly UK, the Citizens Assembly established by the UK Parliament. Previously, she was a research fellow for the iGov project at the University of Exeter, investigating energy governance. In 2009, Rebecca founded Green Alliance's Climate Leadership Programme, an initiative to support the members of the UK Parliament. So now we're going to show you a video, which is her keynote, because unfortunately she can't join us in person.
Thank you very much for the chance to talk to you today. It's brilliant to see how you're getting together to talk about your role and how you as a local area will take action on climate. I'm a professor in practice at Lancaster University, and my work looks at climate governance and specifically how to tackle climate change in a democracy. And a lot of what I'm saying today is based on this book, Too Hot to Handle, The Democratic Challenge of Climate Change, which I published last year. As I'll go on to talk about today, I think that local areas have an absolutely critical role to play in climate action. And I don't think you've had enough support or acknowledgement of the importance of that role. So events like today's are a brilliant way of taking stock, building momentum and making a plan. And I find making plans very therapeutic. I've done a lot of it lately, even if it's just a plan for getting through a lockdown day. In my comments today, I will first of all look at the state of play on climate, then look at some of the challenges ahead over the next decade, and I'll end with bringing that back to what that means for local partnerships like yours. So the state of play on climate, I mean, I think it's summed up by probably the most quoted Dickens ever. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. So I've worked on climate for 20 years and I've never known it to have the priority it does at the moment. In the US election last year, in the debate about COVID recovery, in the minds of so many, particularly young people, like in the incredible climate strike movement. But it's also the worst of times, and every time that I open a paper or report about climate science, I'm reminded of the horrifically serious situation we find ourselves in. And it's really difficult but necessary to read and really take in what the scientists are telling us and what it means for our future, for our children's future, and for the prospects of humans and other species on this planet. And I don't know if you're familiar with David Wallace Wells's book called The Uninhabitable Earth, but he summarises the science in just one phrase. And I think he's absolutely right. He says, it's worse, much worse than you think. So it's also the best of times and the worst of times because we have this contradiction that we see in our politics all the time. So in the UK, we have world leading climate legislation. We have a zero carbon goal, which has wide political support. But we're also seeing just last week, the government decided not to intervene to stop a new coal mine just down the road from me in Cumbria. So we have this real contradiction now, I think, in climate. And later on in that same paragraph, Dickens says it was the spring of hope, it was the winter of despair. And I'm sort of constitutionally an optimist, but sometimes it is more despair than hope. So what can we expect over the next 10 years? Well, I not only hope, but I think that this focus on climate will continue, and not least because sadly we're seeing more climate impacts here and around the world, and people are joining the dots between extreme weather events and the climate crisis. But also, the focus will continue because it's driven by the constant efforts of those who try and keep it on the agenda, amongst young people, as I've said, amongst many businesses who feel a moral responsibility and an economic opportunity, and by some politicians. But I think the politics of this all is going to get sharper for two reasons. Firstly, because until now, we haven't really asked people to play much of a role. It's been quite an expert-led agenda. We've done what I've called climate policy by stealth. We've focused on those things like decarbonising the power sector and industry that can be done without people noticing. So at best, we've engaged a minority of environmentally minded voters or conscious consumers. But we need everyone involved in the changes over the decade ahead. So if you look at transport, for example, eliminating all petrol and diesel cars, reducing car use overall, switching to active travel, more localised living. If you look at food, we need to reduce meat and dairy consumption. We need to support farmers to manage land in very different ways to store carbon. So this transition will mean reaching behind nearly everyone's front door to make sure heating systems are zero carbon, literally behind everyone's front door. The list goes on. People will need to do things differently. And as I'm sure you've thought many times, there are a lot of benefits to this shift, benefits to health, to the economy, to our communities. But it is a change, and change is difficult. Climate change will change our lives, and it's vital that we listen to people and involve them in the changes ahead. And that's why the absolute highlight of last year for me, if not my career, was Climate Assembly UK. I was an expert lead for this process, which selected 108 citizens who were representative of their country as a whole in terms of age, gender, educational level and so on. We brought them together, allowed them to hear from experts and debate with them and with each other, and come up with a set of recommendations for what should happen on climate, which worked for those 108 citizens, taking into account their own views and lived experience. And there's lots of local examples of these processes too, like citizens' assemblies and citizens' juries, which really help to engage people in the challenge. So the second reason that things are going to hot up over the next decade is that getting to our climate targets is also about stopping doing some things. And there has been a tendency to focus on all the positives, like switching to renewable energy or recycling. And that's good, but it's not enough. I call it the feel-good fallacy if we are only focusing on those sort of positive steps. It makes us feel better, but it's only part of the picture. We also need to stop doing things, and particularly at source, we need to stop taking fossil fuels out of the ground. And this is really challenging politically, because at the moment our economy is so dependent on fossil fuels. Just one example, the case for Scottish independence relies on revenues from North Sea oil and gas. And also because it will impact differently on different areas. So look how much politics in the US is driven by debates about jobs in coal and shale gas. So I think up until now, it's been a bit of a phony war, really. We haven't tackled some of these real difficult issues and ambiguities around climate change. It's going to get a lot more real. So lastly, what does this mean for local areas? How will it plan out for particular localities? Over the past couple of years, it's just been brilliant to see these climate emergency declarations which have sprung up. They started in Bristol, in the UK anyway, they started in Bristol, and they spread to hundreds of local areas. The councillor, Carla Denyer, who started the first one in Bristol, said that she'd never been more happy to have her homework copied. So we have these really strong statements of a climate emergency. But there's now a real gap that's opened up between these stated declarations and actual action. And that's partly because local areas and local authorities don't have formal responsibilities or targets or powers or the budget to work on this. And this is at a time when local authorities and many local services are only just keeping afloat. To be honest, they were only just keeping afloat before the pandemic. But recent research that I've been involved in as part of a team at Lancaster, which isn't published yet, we talked to local officials and politicians to see how they understood the problem. And, you know, it was a cautiously good picture. Local officials and politicians are feeling the pressure to act. They feel it from their communities, from the businesses they work with. But that gap between the stated ambition and the delivery is pretty huge at the moment. But they understand this, and that is half the battle. So there is a really strong case, and one that I put to government and many other people as well put to government, for devolution of climate responsibilities, for giving local areas the responsibility and the powers and the budget to really lead the charge in terms of local climate action. I think that's essential, but there's plenty that we can do in the meantime. It's really crucial to keep the pressure up, and that will mean different things to different people. Often it just means something as simple about as talking about climate change, raising it in meetings, even talking to neighbours, talking on the football touchline in my case, keeping that pressure up within your organisation and among the links that you have. I think it does also mean protest. I think protest is really important. And there's a funny irony here, which is the least likely protester you are, the less that you look and feel like a protester, the more effective is your protest, because pardon me, because it then makes it clear that it's not just the usual suspects, that it is, you know, a very broad-based movement. And of course, there's lots you can do in your own life to reduce your carbon footprint. I mean, I always put that last on the list because, you know, it's vital to do that, to think about whether you need to fly, although chance would be a fine thing at the moment, whether you need to fly, how you travel, about your diet and so on. It's important to do that, but it's just as important to talk about why you're taking those steps and to pressure government, to pressure businesses, to make sure that it's easier for other people, because this has to become the norm. So I think the terrible situation we're in right now with the pandemic makes keeping the pressure up on climate actually all the more crucial, because the opportunity for a climate focused recovery is there for the taking. The you know, it's something that politicians understand the need for. It is possible, but just because it's necessary and just because we have all the evidence that it needs to be done doesn't mean it will happen. It needs people and organisations to talk, to act, to step up. And that's why sessions like today's are so important. That sharing of knowledge, that sort of joint motivation is absolutely critical. So I hope you have a really productive day, and I look forward to hearing your conclusions. Thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca. I'm going to give her a clap anyway, even though she's not here to receive it. wow, some really great words there. The best of times and the worst of times, huh? We've got probably 1 minute for just, I thought I'd invite you to share your thoughts in the chat, maybe just one or two words, because we can't do a Q&A. So if you've got one or two words you want to pop in the chat, something you got from that video, something that's made you think, or something that stuck out for you. So I'm just going to give you 1 minute to do that, just as a quick. See what pops up. So any words, insights, thoughts, pop them in the chat, and then we've got a little poll for you to do. Talk about it, protest, take action. Wow, loads of things. Personal responsibility, hope through action, thought provoking. It's all about people. I'm just reading a handful of these. Opportunity. Lots of opportunity. We need to stop doing things, not just positive steps. Agree that we need to extend the range of people being actively engaged beyond the usual suspects. Action needed. Great, some really nice thoughts coming up there. So feel free to add any more as they come up. Maybe you belatedly have a thought you'd like to share. So what we've got next is a poll. So this is using a tool called Mentimeter. I'm going to hand over to Megan in a minute, who's going to share the link and explain to you what to do. And it's a key question that we've got to ask you, which is, how do you feel about your organization's ability to tackle the climate crisis? So over to you, Megan. So Megan's just put the link in the chat.
So in the chat box, there's a link. You can just click on the hyperlink, which is in blue, and it should take you to menti.com. Or if you can't, or you're on an iPad or even want to use a phone, you can visit menti.com. And then you can type in 17, 32, 36, 4. So probably easier just to click on the blue link. But if you'd like to do it the other way, that's fine. And there's some the question that Helen asked, which is, how do you feel about your organization's ability to tackle the climate crisis? And I'd like you to just have a think and put your answers in the boxes. I will share the screen in a second. We've already got daunted, so thank you for that. I will share the screen as well to share. So have a little think. I'm sharing the screen now, so I'm going to read some out, but please continue to put in your answers. We've got apprehensive, we've got overwhelmed, but we've also got challenging, positive, accelerating, lots to learn, full of potential. So quite a lot of adjectives here, Helene.
Amazing.
It's nice to see quite a lot. As you can see, if you're looking at my shared screen, the Menti, it's quite good really, but as people add words, it changes. Eventually it will settle down, but lots of adjectives here. Slightly concerned, under-resourced, timely, welcomed. So some slight anxiety here, which is understandable, but also some very positive thoughts here. Okay, over to you, Helene.
Thank you. I was going to say something and then it all changed. And what I was going to say was that the larger the word, the more people have said that. And the word in the middle was positive and now it's changed to challenging. So that's interesting. We'll just give you a couple more minutes. If you haven't had a chance to vote, then we'll just give you a little more time. Really interesting stuff coming up. The determined is another one. Determined, yeah. Positive, confident, hopeful. Those are all sort of fairly bold, those words, which means that the bigger the word, the more bold it is, more people have said that. So that's kind of good. But challenging, yep, seems to be the one that's come up the most. So what we'll do is we'll save this and you can, oops, there we go. Have another look at it later if you want to. Thank you very much for participating in that. Now, we are going to start talking about breakout rooms, which is going to be the sort of the middle section and the bit where you get to actually do some hard work. So I'm just going to share my screen again, which will explain what the breakout rooms are all about. If I can get my slides to move forward. I don't seem to be doing that.
Yes, they're working fine. I can see that. Yeah, you're on the agenda now.
Oh, there we go. Breakout rooms. My keyboard's really stiff for some reason. Anyway, so we have, I think now we have 8 breakout rooms.
Yeah.
They are spread across 5 main topics, which are energy, transportation, resource and materials management, biodiversity, and communications. Each of these groups has a breakout group leader. Some of the groups have 2 breakout group leaders and some only have 1. These are topic experts that you will be hearing from shortly. They each have, I've given them a generous 3 minutes each after I finish talking to tell you a bit about their subject. So each of these groups will have a topic to focus on. You'll be randomly assigned to groups. So if you are, for example, in a group that is about biodiversity, but biodiversity is not something you know a lot about, please don't worry. We're heading for cross-pollination of ideas and sharing of thoughts. So that's what it's all about. We haven't put all the biodiversity experts together and the energy experts together or anything like that. It's a bit more mixed up than that. You will have 20 minutes to discuss a key question, which I will share with you in a minute. I would ask that you allow everyone time to speak. We've got a maximum of 8 people per group. So that's hopefully large enough to get a good discussion going, but small enough so that everybody feels comfortable and confident to be able to share their thoughts and be respectful of each other's contributions as well. I would add that you'll be adding your ideas on a Google Doc, which we will share with you shortly. As part of being respectful, please don't delete other people's comments. That can happen either accidentally or purposefully, but if somebody writes a comment in the document, then that's for them to leave there, shall we say. And after we've come out of the breakout rooms, then we will choose one of the breakout group leaders will be able to feed back. So they'll have a couple of minutes to feed back what you discovered in your group. So as you will realise, this is fairly sort of fast paced. Actually, there's a lot of research that says, you know, time constraints get you thinking quicker and can generate some really good ideas. So it's not a lot of time, but actually we're hoping you can you'll be able to come up with some really good discussions. I'm just going to share the question with you here. This is the question. Within your own organisations and acting as a collective through Cheltenham Zero, what actions could you take and what support could you give to enable Cheltenham to reach net zero? And you will be answering that question in the context of the topic focus group that you are in. Okay. So hopefully, I'm just going to stop sharing my screen for the slides and just give you a quick look at the Google Doc so you can see, hang on a second, the kind of thing that you're going to be looking at. So it's this. So we've got seven or eight different templates in a Google document. Each will have the question at the top. They'll have the topic and the person that's leading the group. I suggest that you perhaps choose a scribe, someone to write into the document rather than everybody write, but that's up to you in your groups. And we've divided, so the question is, what actions could you take? So writing the actions in the left-hand column, and what support could you give? So that's writing the support in the right-hand column. So that's the document that you will be populating in your groups. And we will give you a link to that nearer the time when you're actually, we're not going into the breakout groups until after we've had a break. And then we'll give you the link to be able to access that Google document. Okay, are there any quick questions? If there are, type them in the chat now. We will also be popping in, the facilitators or myself at least will pop in and out of the groups just to check that you're not having any problems and that everything's running smoothly. Okay.
And if you've never been in breakout rooms, don't worry, you don't have to do anything. I will magically move you, teletransport you like Star Trek into the rooms. So if you're thinking, I don't know what to do, don't worry, it'll be sorted.
Yeah, don't panic. Anna, you're going to leave and come back in. That's completely fine. Right, so without further ado, I'm going to hand over to the breakout group leaders. Now, as I said, you've got a generous 3 minutes each. I have brought my singing bowl with me. So when 3 minutes is up, you're going to have a little noise playing, and that's your means time's up. So yeah, that's what will happen to you if you overstay your 3 minutes. Now, in order of breakout rooms, so breakout room one is focusing on energy, and we have Owen McQuone, Managing Director of Sustainable Business Design, and James Clark from 7Y. I believe, Owen, you are doing the speaking, is that correct?
I am indeed. It's actually Ian, but you're forgiven.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
How do you pronounce that one? Sorry.
I Googled it to find out.
Oh, that's pretty good. Yeah.
Sorry.
No, no.
To you.
Splendid. Thank you very much indeed. Can you all see my slides?
We can.
Splendid. So, hi. As just been introduced, I'm Ian McQuone from Go Climate Positive, and I help businesses to calculate, reduce, and offset their carbon footprint. My co-discussion leader is James Clark from 7Y Energy Agency, who provide advice and access to grants for energy efficiency and renewable energy. So we heard from Rebecca that the UK was the first country in the world to make a legally binding commitment to net zero emissions. But what does net zero actually mean? Well, here's the official version. Anthropogenic emissions simply means the emissions that are produced by people. And net zero means that those emissions are balanced by people removing an equivalent amount of greenhouse gases from the atmosphere. Now you might say, great, all we need to do is plant enough trees to remove the amount of carbon we're producing. But that's really not practical. I've done a bit of fag packet calculations and worked out, I reckon we need to plant something like 2.3 trillion trees by 2040 to remove the emissions we produced in 2020, never mind any additional that we had in the meantime. That would need an area of over 7 million square miles, which is equivalent to the whole of Russia and the three biggest European countries, France, Spain, and Sweden combined. So we don't have the space to plant enough trees or the technology to remove all the emissions we're making today, which means we need to make deep reductions in emissions so the amount we have to remove is reduced to a manageable level. And as a good guide, there's a minimum position to achieve the global ambition of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees C. This carbon law is a good guideline which says we need to halve our emissions every 10 years to 2050 as a minimum. And of course, we know that Cheltenham has set a more ambitious target. What's left at the end of that period, we need to physically remove from the atmosphere. So how do we get there? What does a roadmap to net zero look like? Well, it follows a process like this. It involves calculating all of your emissions for which your business is responsible to create a baseline calculation. Set targets to reduce your emissions in line with science-based, with the carbon law, also known as science-based targets. Eliminating, reducing, or substituting all avoidable emissions. Checking progress annually, and ultimately balancing what you, the unavoidable emissions with removing carbon from the atmosphere. So the first step is to calculate all our greenhouse gas emissions. How do we do that? Something called the Greenhouse Gas Corporate Protocol Standard tells us how to do it. Breaks down the carbon footprint of your business by where the emissions are generated, also known as the scope of the emissions. The scopes are further broken down into 18 different categories. Not all will apply to every business. So to calculate your carbon footprint correctly requires you to identify which categories are relevant. The goal being to cover at least 95% of your footprint and include any activity that accounts for more than 1% of the total. Now, this slide might come as a bit of a shock to some of you because the clue's in the title of this breakout room. People only tend to think about energy. But in fact, for most businesses, around about 80% of their carbon emissions are in their value chain. I will be super quick. So what does a carbon reduction plan look like? We can use this hierarchy, which is just like the reduce, reuse, recycle waste hierarchy, but this is for greenhouse gas measurement, which says we should eliminate before we reduce, before we substitute, and finally only then think about compensating. I was asked to explain the difference between net zero and carbon neutral very briefly, because people tend to think they're the same. The difference is with carbon neutral, you can decide which emissions you include in your carbon neutrality claim. You don't have to make any reductions at all. You can just balance whichever emissions you've decided are in scope. And balancing is often about reducing emissions somewhere else, which doesn't address the unavoidable emissions. Now, that doesn't mean that every target of carbon neutrality is like this. And indeed, the Cheltenham one is particularly comprehensive, but it does mean you need to dig behind the surface to find the detail. So when we get to the breakout, we are going to be focusing on actions. So we'll revisit this greenhouse gas hierarchy. The last thing I'd like to say to you is, I know that was an absolute whistle stop tour. If you'd like to see some more of that or find out some more, I do run a free webinar every month, which explains everything I've just done but you've got a whole hour to get your head around it. So I'll pop the details of that in the chat, and you'd all be very welcome to join one of those webinars. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. And yes, please do pop your link in the chat. Would you be able to? Oh, hello. Great, you're back again. So next up we have, so group two is focusing on transportation and distribution. That's Pete Wiggins, Corporate Strategic Lead for Carbon Reduction and Resilience from Gloucester County Council, and Matt Cleveley, the MD of Cleveley Electric Vehicles. And I believe it's Pete Wiggins who is talking to us at the moment. Over to you.
Good morning, thank you. I just wanted to just quickly share a chart, if this will let me. So just bear with me a moment. So I work for Gloucestershire County Council, and I am the strategic lead on all things sort of climate change and sustainability. And I just thought it'd be worth starting off by sharing the CO2 carbon dioxide emissions data that's published by government 2 years in arrears.
We can't.
So, and the reason.
Sorry, Peter.
Can you not see that? Right. Okay. Not to worry. It's sharing is sharing, and if it's not, then apologies. But basically, this puts this publishes every year, 2 years in arrears, detailed information on what makes up an area's emissions, and it does it at the national, regional, county-wide, and at the district level as well. And for Cheltenham in 2018, industrial and commercial emissions made up just over a third, 36% of emissions. Heating from households, domestic emissions was 42%, and transport was 22%, so just over a fifth. So in terms of that, for the county as a whole, so transport emissions make up around about a third. And the main reason for that, I would hope, will be relatively obvious in that Cheltenham is a much more urban location. It's much more compact, so much more opportunity to travel by alternative means. So you would expect there to be fewer transport emissions from the use of the private car. Whereas countywide, we've got much more of a rural urban mix. As I hope you will also be aware, air quality is a significant issue, particularly in urban areas. And Cheltenham's had an air quality management area. And air pollution can have significant health impacts. And in fact, very recently, we had the first death nationally where the coroner actually attributed the cause of that as air quality. The main shift, certainly for individuals, is going to be the government's new target brought forward to 2030 of banning the sale of fossil-fueled vehicles that are cars and vans. And the main shift for that, certainly in the medium term, is going to be to electric. There are a number of issues going on across Cheltenham in terms of ourselves as the Highways Authority. The West Cheltenham development, the improvements to the junctions of the M5, and the redevelopment of what is currently the Isle Court Park and Ride, which will be known as the Isle Court Transport Hub, including additional private parking and electric vehicle charging facilities, which we're hoping will be renewable. So they'll be charged using solar panels. And as the Transport Authority and the Highways Authority, we publish local transport plan. The most recent one has just been published and is available on our County Council website. And that's just been refreshed in light of our climate change strategy, almost finished. So we as a County Council are reducing our own emissions by to be net zero by 2030. And for Gloucestershire as a whole to be net zero by 2045, given the rural and urban split. So we just need to consider in terms of our workshop, things like, you know, how the last mile of a journey delivery is undertaken, the use of electric vehicles, the infrastructure making that possible, and the impacts on air quality and pollution in general. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Peter. Okay, the next group is focusing on resources and materials management, and that's Karen Watson, Environmental Partnerships Manager at Cheltenham Borough Council, and Dave Entwistle, CEO of Vision 21. I believe Karen Watson will be speaking to us. Over to you, Karen.
Good morning, all. 3 minutes isn't very long, but we'll do our best. So resources and materials management, well, that's reducing, reusing, that's talking about water, food, and general waste. Well, how does all that relate to achieving net zero carbon in Cheltenham? Interesting question. If we talk recycling, and this often makes us feel quite virtuous because we think we're doing the right thing, and I'm sure we can all appreciate that anything we consume has to be grown, produced, manufactured, probably packaged, and then it has to get to us. And that's plane, boat, train, lorry, van, etc. All equals carbon emissions, and that's on top of everything required to actually get that product to us in the first place. Well, recycling's great, and given the amount of carbon emissions in just getting it to our doorstep, the least we can do as a household or a business is to recycle. But recycling really is the salvage operation, and we're dealing with symptoms, not the root cause. What we need to do globally, that's at home in our businesses, is to find ways to reduce what we consume. So reduction in consumption and therefore waste is absolutely essential. And it begs the question, well, what can we buy less of? How could we buy or sell things with less packaging, waste less, etc., all that will reduce carbon emissions? Well, I'd like to bring us back to some basics. What's the most basic requirement to sustain life? Well, I think we'd all agree it's water. Without water, there's no life. Climate change has meant that really we've either got drought in some parts of the world or floods. And we saw that in Cheltenham in 2007. So we're not immune to it here. I'm sure many of you, like me, heard from parents as you were growing up or the schools, etc. Turn the tap off. Make sure the tap isn't dripping. Use a shower instead of a bath. Share a bath even, what I thought. Don't flush the loo so often. And all these things are still relevant today, but how many of us are still remembering these principles and how much is still happening in our workplace or our businesses? Well, how can we make those changes? Well, maybe maintenance on our plumbing, installing systems that use less water. Let's try and find a way of saving some money, perhaps on our water bill if we're a homeowner or a business. Every little bit helps, particularly if we start thinking about the hidden footprint of water. And that's an interesting subject of itself. Did you know that it takes 22 gallons of water to make 1 pound of plastic? And I'm holding up a plastic bottle here, and it takes at least twice as much water to make this plastic bottle as the amount of water that's in it. Now, moving to refillable containers helps, reusing where we can, tap water definitely helps the environment and certainly reduces the amount of plastic being used. In Cheltenham, we're really helpful in terms of making sure that we've got the plastic-free group working with businesses. And just a few very quick, interesting statistics here, and I've got loads more that we could share. But just to make a smartphone takes 3,190 gallons of water. A T-shirt is 659 gallons of water. So given these really staggering figures, it's really important that we're reusing where we possibly can. And we've been working with Vision 21 and Reclaim for many years within the council just to try and make sure that people are putting products to them that they can be actually reused. So thinking about mending clothes, thinking about whether electrical goods can actually be sent back for repair and reuse. Getting further back to basics, we're talking about food. Well, in Cheltenham here, we've got an amazing nighttime economy. It's a festival town. I know COVID's presenting many challenges for us at the moment, but lots of great hospitality venues. And that food that we're wasting is staggering. So did you know that it's about £19 billion worth of food that we're wasting in this country every year? That's 920,000 tonnes of food. So really, if you excuse the pun, I hope that's some food for thought, that we really do need to be doing something a little bit different moving forward. And my time, I'm hoping, isn't too bad for you.
Brilliant. Thank you, Karen. That's amazing. Just on 3 minutes. Lovely. Okay. So next we have the topic group is biodiversity, and our topic leads are Nick Grayson, Climate Change and Sustainability Manager at Birmingham City Council, and Jackie Jobes, the Cheltenham Borough Council Townscape Manager. We also have Adrian Phillips, who's a retired planner involved in the work of World Heritage Convention and the European Landscape Convention. Now, I believe we have Nick Grayson, who's going to be talking to us. Your 3 minutes starts now.
Hello, everyone. Yes, biodiversity is basically all the living organisms on Earth. And you will have all seen the return of Attenborough to our screens pointing out both the wonder and the awe of wildlife, but also that whole issue of its loss and rapid decline. And in fact, as alongside the climate emergency, we all face an ecological emergency. And the information coming to us is saying that there's been a complete crash in things like the invertebrates, insects, pollinators, and that's right at the bottom of the food chain. And of course, the government have got proposals now that we should look at nature recovery plans. So we all need to play a part in that. And through lockdown, you will have probably got to know your local area a lot more than you thought you knew before. And this whole access to green space and nature on your doorstep is something that really needs to be thought very carefully about, and how the look and feel of Cheltenham should be going forwards in these next 10 years. That links to the whole planning process, which of course will have a policy of saying biodiversity net gain, that's that biodiversity should be increased through a plan. But when you look, if you're chasing housing targets, you could create a massive housing estate that is very dependent on cars with very little public transport. And of course, if it's being built on a greenfield site, what is it that you're losing and how do you make these connections? And should the whole thing be linked up through walking and cycling? So there's a direct link between biodiversity, how it appears, how it's controlled through the planning process, and that affects the overall townscape in terms of what does Cheltenham look and feel like, and what should it look like in 2030? Because as Rebecca Willis pointed out, a lot of the changes that have happened in response to climate so far have been invisible. So should we actually have a Regency town with solar panels or turbines or electric volt charging points? What should actually the new aesthetic for Cheltenham really look like? And as businesses, what would you really like to see Cheltenham looking like? And as already been mentioned, it's a festival town, it's a destination. How can that all be linked up in a way that protects and preserves and makes it a green place and a really, really attractive place? So in our workshop, what we're going to be looking at is you need a vision. You need something that you all want to sign up to. And then, like Rebecca Willis said, you need to stop doing certain things. What is it that we're doing right now that's causing harm or damage to those things? And what is it that we need to start doing or do more of that will actually take us to that new vision point? So that's what we're looking at. Thank you.
Thank you. That's the best to time 3 minutes so far. Thank you. Wow. So many interesting things to think about. Okay. Last group is all about communications. And we have Caroline Astrop, Creative Director of Green Spark Marketing, and Rachel Kelly from the Liminality. And Caroline, I believe you're giving us your 3 minute talk.
I am. Yes. Thank you very, very much, Helen. I just want to share my screen with you. Where is he? Oh, I can't find. There it is. Can you all see that okay?
Yep.
You can, great, thank you. Yes, thank you very much for asking me. Green Spark is an agency, it's my own agency that helps clients to turn their sustainability story and their sustainability commitments into great PR and storytelling. And it's fantastic that this group has been set up as part of this whole discussion, because often PR communications is something that gets left off the agenda. You know, the number of times I've talked to businesses who say, oh, I know I should be doing my PR, but I can't afford it, or I haven't got time. And it's often seen as something that we get done really quickly. I've been in the sustainability sector for 34 years, since the times when most people didn't have a clue what it was all about. And I was taught at parties when I was asked what I did for a living to be just plain weird, and would people would start backing away. So I certainly agree with Councillor Max Watson that there has been an incredible change in attitude towards sustainability, and particularly from businesses. I've seen in the past few years, 2-3 years, an incredible increase in the amount of businesses that are wanting to be sustainable, because previously businesses did see this as something that was anti their business, anti growth, would hamper them, would cost them too much money. But actually, I just wanted to point out a few things that are reasons why businesses should not only consider embracing sustainability in their business model, but also communicate it. there are many, many benefits from businesses communicating to the public and to their target audiences what they are doing to be responsible. In the past 10, 15 years, there's been a great increase in the amount of studies looking at what's called environmental psychology, looking at how people respond to the environmental messages and their attitudes towards being sustainable. 65% of customers now feel that they should be purchasing items that are good for the environment society. They want to be really doing their part to actually help be more sustainable and change to greener lifestyles, but often don't know where to start. Study by Traction showed, a market research company showed that 87% of consumers actually looking for those companies that are linking themselves to a good cause. You know, it's profit with purpose now is becoming much more of a driving force, in, not only in the business models, but also in the public's mind. And about a year ago, Nielsen carried out a global survey. Nielsen is a big market research company globally, a report called Consumers Buy the Change They Wish to See in the World. And they found that 81% of consumers believe very strongly that companies must be doing whatever they can to introduce sustainability into their practices and to be environmentally responsible. And it's not just B2C companies, it affects B2B as well. The UK Small Business Consortium did a survey. Oh, sorry, just to go back to that previous report. People often think it is just the millennials and the young people who want businesses to be sustainable and want to be sustainable themselves. And actually, Nielsen's survey showed that that's not the case. Here you can see in all these different age groups, we've got millennials on the top right hand. We've got Gen X on the top left hand. We've got the baby boomers in the bottom left-hand corner, and the over 65s in the bottom right corner. You can see with those figures that all age groups now are wanting to be sustainable and wanting companies that they do business with to be sustainable. The UK Small Business Consortium in their survey found that 43% of small companies had been asked by larger companies about their sustainability practices, as larger companies are pushing their own sustainability policies down the supply chain. 29% of businesses surveyed by Centrica in November 2019 reported increased reputational benefits from investing in sustainable energy technologies. Ben & Jerry's have found that their customers are 2.5 times more loyal to them because they know of all the great actions that the company has taken to be socially and environmentally responsible. And a third of workers want their companies to be doing more to tackle climate change. So if your staff know the work that you're doing to be sustainable, it actually increases their motivation and their loyalty to working for the company. So it not only helps to retain your staff, but also it can help in recruiting staff as well. 42% of the UK workforce, which increases to 62% of millennials, want to work for a company making a positive impact on the world. And it's been seen now that once people achieve a level where they get to the amount of salary they need for a decent lifestyle, they actually would prefer to work for a company that has been responsible rather than have a higher salary or have a career to get promotion and a career progress. So it also presents lots of PR opportunities. The media see a company that's being responsible as almost like a charity, not quite, but almost, and be more likely to report about what it's doing in the media. And during the lockdown, in the last 10 months, we've seen the call from businesses for a green economic recovery. So all the signs are now pointing towards being a company is not only being sustainable, but also communicating that as much as they effectively can.
Thank you, Caroline. Okay, now we are going to head into a break. So there's lots of stuff to think about there. I appreciate it was a lot in a very short period of time. Thank you very much to all our topic leaders there who shared a lot of wisdom in a very short period of time. We're just going to pop the question in the chat box again, so you can take it away with you and, should you wish, mull it over while you have your 10-minute coffee break. It is now 10:38. If you could be back here at now 10:39, we'll give you till 10:50. I think that's a nice round number. So come back at 10:50 and be prepared to be popped into breakout rooms and to get chatting with everybody. If you want, don't leave the room, please. If you want to put your cameras off and your mics off, that would be great. But it would be really helpful to us if you don't actually leave the room. See you at 10:02.
So to put your mics off, it's in the bottom left-hand corner, and it's quite good. Otherwise, we can hear you chatting or making your cups of tea or whatever. And there's also the video, so if you'd like to put those off.
Megan, could you pop the link to the Google Doc in the chat will as well?
Do,
and
yeah.
Just so people can investigate yeah. it while they're making themselves a cup
just
of tea.
Grab it now. Oh, and you might want to stop recording, Helene.
Good point. Okay. So I think everybody is back. I've just seen your question, Francis. I'll just explain quickly again how this is going to work. You will be zapped into eight, is that right, Megan? Eight
yeah.
breakout rooms, each of which has a topic leader. So some of them you have just heard from, and some of them hopefully I've introduced earlier, but they didn't actually give a talk just now. And if you click on the link in the chat box here, it will take you to the Google Doc that you will be populating in your group. So I'll just give you a moment to do that. Now there's a couple of ways you can do this in your groups. Either the leader of your group can share his or her screen and write in the Google Doc themselves, and all you need to do is you know, have the discussion. Or you can look at the document in your own browser. So I suggest when you get into your rooms, you make that decision as to whether one person's going to screen share and you all look at their document and they capture the notes, or whether you're individually going to look at the Google document from your own browser. It's probably better to just go into the group and have a go at it. It will probably become clearer when you get into your groups. Megan's just popped the link up there and the question again. Are there any quick questions before we go into the groups? Okay, so Megan, without further ado, I'm going to ask you to pop everybody into groups, and we will give you 20 minutes and we'll pull you back after 20 minutes.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to move you into breakout rooms. It might take you a few seconds in order to arrive there. Don't worry, just sit there, relax. If for whatever reason you're not moved into a breakout room, I will be able to do that manually. Helene, so there are eight breakout rooms. Helene, you're in a separate room on your own, and I can visit you or you can come back. So if there's any problems, there's a help button in the bottom toolbar of your screen, and we will see you. How long have we got, Helene?
We've That's got 20 minutes.
20 minutes, so I will put my timer on and I will give you a 10 minute and a 5 minute sort of warning. Okay, and Helene, you might want to stop recording or pause recording.
I will.
Work, and so we popped that forward. There was a few suggestions about bulk buying schemes, and actually working using the network, the Cheltenham Zero network, to be able to do more together than separately trying to do things as individuals. But largely we were on the same sort of lines as your group, Ian. We perhaps just had a more in-depth discussion on that substitution and on-site renewable generation.
Lovely, thank you. So James, you were in the second.
That's right, there was two of us, yeah.
Right, yeah. So that's both of those groups. Okay, so the transportation and distribution, Peter, your group.
Thank you. The mute button does turn out to be quite elusive. Very quickly, so we had a bit of a wide-ranging discussion, but the main thing I was asked, my view in terms of what I thought was the most important, and that being behaviour change, which everyone seemed to agree with. And point was made in terms of educating individuals so that there was an informed rather than misinformed debate, and Boots Corner was cited as an example. And in terms of the switch of individuals from the fossil fuel vehicles to ultra low emission vehicles, that's what ULEV means. How is government going to incentivize that? Everyone has a role to play in bringing about behavior change, whether it's your individual actions as an organization, as a community. So it can't just be up to government and us as local authorities. What is the overall vision for the city centre of for the town centre of Cheltenham? Looking at transport planning and infrastructure, publicly, it's difficult to see the connective thinking that's taking place. So Jill Morris from Cheltenham was just given a brief overview in terms of what vehicles the Cheltenham uses and the fleet review that's happening. And we're looking at electric, and that's not suitable for all types of vehicles. I just need to try and scroll down the Google Docs. Buildings, organisations needing to rationalise how their offices are used, looking at the impacts and consequences from coronavirus, also the electric vehicle and other infrastructure that might be needed across Cheltenham. And our role, Gloucestershire as the transport authority and Cheltenham as part of their role being the housing authority. I think that's probably my 2 minutes.
Thank you, Peter. And just one comment in there, an observation from Sarah: when organisations are calculating their carbon footprinting with remote working, this may need to consider the footprint of staff working from home. Okay, thank you. So next group is Karen Watson, your group, please.
Yes, I'm going to report back for the group. I sort of started off by giving a small example of what could be done quite quickly to get some CSR support or a bit of PR within your organisation. And that's the example of a cable box scheme to recycle old computer flexes and things like that. But then we started talking about a more strategic approach and the kind of waste hierarchy triangle, where you've got to reduce, reuse, recycle and repair and try and get more of that element involved and a consciousness amongst your workforce and amongst homes as well. We thought that there was a greater need for communication on what could be recycled in general, because we talked about bins having the wrong thing. It's a public education system that's possibly needed to get people to put the right things in the right box and understand the consequences of not doing it correctly, and of course to encourage them to actually do it. What businesses could do is lobby their suppliers about what suppliers they're getting, how it's packaged, things like that, so they've got a choice over things. For instance, like wonky vegetables were mentioned. If they're going straight into a hotel kitchen, nobody's going to bother if they're wonky or not, because nobody's actually going to see them. So there's different ways to use other things that may not be pristine. We need to encourage people to make the right choices. And obviously, there's a trade-off between cost and delivery. And some of these, the deliveries may be made profitable by gaining stuff through marketing and that sort of way. So there's that trade-off to be made. We thought about tourists coming to town using the hotels and things. Would they expect pristine toilet roll, for instance, or do they want grey recycled toilet roll? And it's a question of managing expectations of people coming to Cheltenham. And we thought there may be an opportunity to raise awareness of our 2030 target and get people to think, well, things might be a bit different when we go to Cheltenham. It's going to be like the grey toilet roll, or we'll be in some places maybe using harvested rainwater and things like that. So it'll have a different feel. So we've got to manage expectation of people visiting and working here. And Ubico offers a recycling service. Other providers also offer a recycling service in addition just to waste removal. But we need to encourage businesses to look at that, because there is a charge involved with that, and it's a question of balancing conscience against actual PR and other things.
Thank you. Okay, is that okay to move on to the next group now, Dave?
Unless anybody else has got anything to comment, Karen? No, we're okay.
Lovely, thank you. So next we have group four, which is Nick Grayson. I see there are a few comments, so you can have a look at the comments.
Hi, yes. So I don't know if anyone had selected our group, but it was a terrific group in that they represented some of the key assets from a land point of view and opportunities in and around Cheltenham that are currently proposing significant changes or adaptations for their land and base. And basically they all already were thinking very strongly around sustainability and biodiversity. However, they weren't collectively connected to the Wildlife Trust, who was also in the room, with their ambitions on a nature recovery network plan for the area. And we all felt that there was a real opportunity here for a working group where those initiatives could come together and agree on some core principles. It would help sort of redefine Cheltenham in terms of that 2030, what it might look like, and start a sort of comms campaign around a real pride of Cheltenham being a town of nature. And that could engage with communities, schools, and the like. So there's a real opportunity for the businesses to promote what they are already committed to or planning to do, some of which is very good and very ambitious. But we've got an opportunity there where we can actually link those agendas and physically look at whether or not it's possible to link those spaces so that you could create future green corridors, either for wildlife or also for wildlife and people, connecting those outer sites to the town, and look at how the townscape could be, as part of the placemaking agenda, introducing more and greater opportunities for subtle introduction of wildlife and diversity in that, so that you have a comprehensive approach to the way in which biodiversity is handled and integrated into the future thinking of the town and how the town progresses, and how all these things underpin the town's commitment to climate change and become a public and visible element of that agenda.
Thank you, Nick. Okay, the next group we have is Caroline's group, the comms group. Hi. Oh, I know I had some technical difficulties, so thank you.
I'm Mickley for the communications department.
Thank you, Rachel.
Hi, yeah, it's Rachel here. It's great as well to see comms and behaviour change stuff basically popping up in all of the other groups as well. That's brilliant. We had some great contributions from Daya Brewery and from GCHQ, and both were talking about the importance of social media to reach customers and reach local staff and citizens, and involving employees and customers in those conversations, and not leaving the comms until like an afterthought, so involving comms teams from the very start, so that, you know, that is all kind of baked in to the end message that you're trying to get out of climate and sustainability. Some exciting projects like carbon capture small scale at breweries, and using those smaller sort of tech projects, even if they're not you know, it's only a small element of your emissions overall, that actually you can kind of draw people in with those sort of exciting tech projects, especially in Cheltenham, where we're a very tech-based town, to then talk about wider things around carbon footprints. And also offsetting like peat restoration projects, which Daya was looking at. So I think that carbon offsetting doesn't always have to be trees. It can actually also cover stuff like peat restoration, or even seaweed, which is a pet project of mine that I'm very excited about. So yeah, and then overall, in terms of the communications in general, we talked about the fact that Cheltenham is known as a festival town, a party town since Regency times. And it's about really creating that vision, like the previous speaker was saying about the aesthetic of the town, that actually if we create that vibe of, coming here for a good time, whether that's horse racing or show, whatever it is, the festival or the cyber park, whatever the reason is why people are coming to Cheltenham, that actually the vision that we're presenting is of a positive future. And it really does become a kind of future focused town, and that's what it's known for. So the support that was mentioned was obviously joining up to Cheltenham Zero and committing to the agreement going forwards.
Thank you, Rachel. Okay, next group, Megan, if you could scroll down. So I think James has already fed back or added to Ian's energy stuff already. Jackie, your group. Couple of minutes, if you could just give us the highlights, that would be amazing.
Yeah, no problem, I'll try to be as quick as possible. So we did cover a little bit about the fact that actually biodiversity isn't necessarily an obvious self-interest as with other topics, and I think it often gets sort of pushed to the side. I think we have it in our hearts as individuals, which is quite clear in the conversation with COVID earlier, and as exploring our own wild spaces quite considerably over the lockdown. However, I think it needs to be disseminated much better. So we did talk about raising further awareness through information dissemination on the kind of smaller things that people can do for biodiversity and townscape level initiatives. We did talk about schools, colleges and universities having a big role to play, particularly as key landowners, and many of them actually having initiatives in place already, tree planting, for example. We looked at the kind of strategic agenda and the need for alignment across the local authorities in particular. So making sure that we are actually working together, and procurement sort of came up as well, making it clearer to residents and businesses across all of the districts what is happening. And we touched on, you're obviously going to bound over to other topics, but we talked about waste and bins as well. The racecourse have a large impact in visitor numbers. So for them, it was exploring how to mitigate this impact, but they are currently laying wildflower meadows wherever they have space, as well as bird boxes and other things. And I think that's a key thing, is no matter how small a space you have, there is some kind of impact that you can make, and bird boxes don't take up much space whatsoever. And then the final thing I just want to say is we did talk about how do we convince people to get involved, and it's about developing case studies. So how can businesses just generate really simple case studies to share with others about the little bits and bobs that they're doing? And I'll end there.
Brilliant. Thank you, Jackie. That's amazing. Okay. And last but not least, we have Matt from Group 8, Transportation. Is Matt still with us?
I muted myself. Sorry. So Pete actually covered quite a lot of what we spoke about in our group as well, but goes back to quite a lot of what other groups have all said, that communication and education is key on all elements of what is today, education with the public and trying to inform people so that they can make the right choices in their own lives, businesses and things like that. So individually from our group, educating and promoting use of more public transport and charging infrastructures and education about electric vehicles and things, it is going to be key. I would urge all businesses that if you're able to, if you've got car parks, then look at putting charging infrastructure within those car parks. It doesn't have to be expensive or fancy, but you've got people that are traveling into the town and we want to reduce emissions from towns and cities. If the charging infrastructure within the car park you're going to spend 8 hours at has somewhere to charge your electric vehicle, it may make you consider electric vehicles as a choice for your family. And it's not ideal for everyone, and we understand that, but education mainly is what we come out of our group with, as well as affordability to add this infrastructure into new builds and anything else that's being added into our county, and a consideration for transportation.
Brilliant, thank you. And thank you to everybody, group leaders and all of you, for making those discussions so rich. And it looks like you came up with a lot of interesting thoughts. There are a lot of comments in the chat box. I'm not going to go through them now, but I will invite you to read them at your leisure. The other thing I didn't mention at the beginning is, if you want to save the chat, there's the little dots on the bottom right. You can save the chat if you want to read it at your leisure later on. But we will be able to send out all the recordings and everything afterwards anyway. So now, without further ado, I am going to hand over to Mike Redman, who's going to talk to us about the agreement and Cheltenham Borough Council's commitment to the partnership. So Mike, over to you.
Thank you much, Elaine. I'm going to start off with some thanks as well. Firstly, to Vision 21 for organising such an innovative event. I think I'm right in saying it's a first for the council to be involved in hosting this sort of event. It's been done in a very short time scale. Thanks also to our keynote speaker, who was very enthusiastic, Professor Rebecca Willis, and also for all of you for participating so enthusiastically in the sessions today. We see great merit in working together to tackle carbon emissions at a local level. And this event, it should be just the start of that. There are already lots of funding opportunities nationally, which can help us on this journey. And a strong partnership will obviously optimize our chances of being successful in making bids into those funds. I think Max Wilkinson's already touched on this to an extent, but there is very clear cross-party support within the council for action on tackling the climate agenda. I think it's sincere. And the authority obviously unanimously declared the climate emergency last year, and also accepted at the same time a consultant report which outlined indicative actions that are required for us to achieve carbon neutrality by 2030, both for the council as an organisation, and perhaps more ambitiously, for the borough as a whole. There's also a similar commitment to act from some of our key close delivery partners, such as Ubico, Cheltenham Borough Homes, and also the Cheltenham Trust. We acknowledge we've still got a lot to do as an organisation in order to reduce our own emissions, but also in terms of transparency about where we are and the challenges we face in terms of delivery. I'm sure within your own organisations you equally face similar challenges and have got similar mountains to climb. So, I mean, from the council's point of view, to that end, we're looking at recruiting a couple of extra full-time staff members to support this. And we'll be regularly publishing information on our website about both the council's emissions and the actions we're taking to reduce them. We also have Max as our dedicated climate lead to champion the agenda locally. Again, as Max has already said, the council can't hope to deliver a carbon neutral borough on its own. And we recognise the need for input and action from the government, individuals, our communities and businesses to deliver on this vision. And that, I hope, is why you've all chosen to give up some of your valuable time to attend today. We don't underestimate the challenge involved here or the scale of what we need to achieve together. Just one example that I can just give you, which I think again may have been alluded to earlier, is the need to wean ourselves off reliance on fossil gas and retrofitting homes currently reliant on gas for heating. with more climate friendly alternatives. That's just one of the challenges we face. It's on a monumental scale. I mean, I've been involved in my career with, when I first started working for the council, putting in basic amenities in properties for the first time. We were still installing inside toilets back in 1990 when I joined the council. We're now talking about having to completely rip out most of the heating systems or replacing the supply of fuel to those with something that is climate friendly. That is a huge, huge challenge. So looking at how we can evidence that commitment of working together, as a first step, working towards establishing a properly constituted Cheltenham Zero Partnership. We're looking for you and your organisations to sign up to this Cheltenham Zero Agreement, which hopefully Helen will move on to now. You can see there. Obviously, this is recognising the climate emergency and the scale of risks it poses to both our environment and to all of our futures, but also critically, it offers the opportunity for organisations to play their part in working to meet the objectives of achieving net carbon zero by 2030. This commitment is obviously critical, as it will help us promote the extent of the partnership and also give confidence to others to participate. I think that is a really important point. And it'll also be a catalyst for wider engagement and action. So in summary, working together, we have a much greater chance of making a meaningful impact. So that's all I wanted to say, really. And I'll now hand back at that point to Helen. Thank you. You're on mute, Helen, I think.
Thank you. You'd think I'd know by now after however long. Right, where's my clap? Thank you very much, Mike. Just, give you a clap as well for your contribution. Imagine we're doing that live. There are a few questions in the chat box, so we don't really have an opportunity to return to specific questions at the moment, but I will invite you to all to have a look at them later on if you're able. So you can download the chat. One group of people we haven't heard from yet is from young people. So they're not physically or virtually present in the group today, mostly because of when this was set up, they would have been at school. So we've got a nice video instead that we're going to share. I'm just going to read a little bit of an introduction to the youth ambassadors. So the youth ambassadors range in age from 11 to 24 and meet to discuss climate issues and give their ideas and input on local projects like Cheltenham Zero. They have also been pivotal in the development of a new project, Planet Cheltenham, which you will hopefully be hearing lots about later this year. They wanted to speak to all the participants in today's conference directly. So in the midst of online schooling, they have made this video so that you can hear the future voices of Cheltenham firsthand. If you would like more information about the Youth Ambassadors Project or know a young person who might like to join, then contact Vision 21 for more details. So I'm just going to ask Megan to share the video.
Young people are the future. We are the future citizens, employees, customers and councillors. So it's important our voices are heard in decisions that will affect us in the long term. One of our youth ambassadors, Isla, says, "Your actions affect my future. Don't just think about money, think about what really matters. If I saw grown-ups in Cheltenham doing work on climate change, I'd feel a lot better about our future."
Tolly has said, "If you aren't prioritising climate and social justice above all else, then you are contributing to a death sentence to not only those at home in Cheltenham, but to those already experiencing the full force of the climate crisis in the global south."
Olympia says, "Eco-anxiety is fueled by a lack of engagement and positive action. For you to respond to the climate crisis with the urgency required, we will have hope for our future."
Ari believes, "We've been brought up knowing we can change the world for the better, with every step having a multitude of positive impacts. The world and its environment needs our local communities to work to ensure stability. And our youths need local communities to show us that they are here to support us, our health and our futures."
Sharaja says, "We see the current situation as a stepping stone for our journey, and with your support, we are looking to continue this positive change by making a collaborative space and bringing awareness into the local community to carry out the necessary change."
Abdul says, "Local organisations leading by example imparts a sense of pride and inspires more to take action."
Ultimately, what's going to happen to the world will happen to us, so of course we feel responsibility for it. However, we are not the people with the power to make large-scale, meaningful decisions. You need to step up and act selflessly, as it would be selfish not to. We need to act now to clean up our planet and be kinder to the environment, and the future will thank us for it.
Thank you. So I'm sure you'll all agree that that is an incredibly impactful 2 minutes, less than 2 minutes, actually. So thank you to all the youth ambassadors. Now, we are coming to a close. I realise that there has been a lot of discussion. There's quite a lot of conversation going on in the chat as well. It's been a really packed couple of hours. But I've got one last little thing for you to do, if that's okay. So first of all, there's some great messages coming in here. I hope this gets fed back to the youth ambassadors. Brilliant video, super messages. So yeah, thank you to all those youth ambassadors again. I'm just going to remind you of the agreement. I'm going to pop the agreement that Mike shared with us earlier in the chat there, just to remind you that this is the thing that we are asking you to sort of commit to in principle, to sort of lend your support to. And we have one final question for you to take away today. And that's in a poll that we're going to introduce in a second, another Mentimeter poll. And that question is, having dedicated 2.25 hours of your morning to taking part in this event, what actions to tackle the climate crisis will you be prioritising in response to today's discussion? So that's the question. The last thing we're going to ask you to do, which is a Mentimeter poll. So Megan's popped the link in the chat there. So just as the one we did in the morning, if you can click on the link and answer the question, it'd be marvellous. Megan, when you're ready, if you're able to share the screen, that would be brilliant.
That's good. I've seen a bit on social media already, so lovely, around hashtag Cheltenham Zero.
Brilliant. So I've realised my autocorrect doesn't like the word Cheltenham somehow.
There we are, education, contacting experts that have spoken today to ask for advice. I'll start scrolling down. Lots of lovely comments. Workshops on calculating carbon footprint. Continued discussions. Yes, vital.
Yeah.
Creating an action plan for 2021. And get going. Yeah, we're only second week of January, but not long before the end of the year. Comms to staff. Lovely.
10-point plan for the business. That sounds good. Marketing campaign. Education. Wonderful. Continuing to help companies and organisations develop their skills. Fantastic. Just give you another minute or two. I think we've had 31 of you. There's a few more of you to add your comments then, so we'll give you a little bit longer. Oh. Improving communication. So communications has come up a few times now, hasn't it? Promoting proposed carbon footprint calculator tool, link on the CBC website and via social media, linking wild Cheltenham to wilder landscapes, working party with the business to identify what we can do to make a difference, getting the branding right. There's definitely some comms and marketing messages coming out here, so the comms team will be pleased to know. Sharing good news stories. What else have we got? So 40 of you have voted so far. We'll just wait a couple more minutes. Look at good examples to demonstrate how it can be done. Building a business roundtable to continue the discussion. Yes, us facilitators are always keen on good discussions. Gloucester Climate Change Strategy. If there are any links, incidentally, I think some of you have done this already, you can pop them in the chat box. So I don't think they're clickable in this document.
No.
Champion local renewable energy delivery storage arrangements. Great. Thank you, Reid, for putting that link in there. Happy to chat about anything relating to the Golden Valley Development Project. Okay. I think there are just a couple more people to add their thoughts. We've got a few links coming up in the chat box as well. Great.
We can share these comments though at the end. So yeah. We'll send them out to you. Yeah.
Brilliant. Okay. I think.
Should I stop sharing now?
Good. Yeah. Stop sharing now.
Lovely.
So we are, I'm afraid, 5 minutes over. It's always a little tricky with these things to manage the time. So hopefully you'll forgive me for stealing 5 minutes extra of your time. As I said, if you'd like to download the chat yourself, you're welcome to do that. Click on the bottom right-hand corner of the three dots. Otherwise, I believe that post-event information will be sent out to you. I'm looking for Peter Clegg here, who hopefully is going to confirm this for me, maybe Dave. And it just leaves me to say thank you very much for all your participation, all your thought sharing, your amazing collaborative sort of spirit for this morning, and your patience with any tech issues that we may have had along the way. So thank you very much. You are free to go.
Okay. Okay. Lots of waving.
Yeah, you can do waving. If anybody's having trouble leaving, just out of interest, bottom right, there's a leave button.
Yeah.
Often people do it accidentally and then can't do it when they actually need to do it.
See you again.
Oh, your sound's gone all funny, Matt. You sounded a little Dalek-like then.
Hopefully I'm not getting Wi-Fi problems for this afternoon session then.
You need more solar panels to drive a higher speed.
Right, yes.
Yeah, Helen, Megan.
More solar panels. I'm not sure there's room enough in my life.
Yeah. So,